Hello, hello, Mordivers here, and welcome to the ninth round of TATA Steel 2021. And I would like to show you the game of this round. Maybe not the best game, but very, very interesting game because it breaks some of the chess principles. So it was quite shocking for many commentators that this game happened and what happened in this game. I'm gonna show you the game between Radosław Wojtaszek from Poland. He's number two in Poland, and his opponent number two in the world. Candidates, pretender to become the world champion and also the winner of Tata Steel 1 year ago, Fabiano Caruana. Fabiano gonna play with the black pieces, and I would like to show you the game from the black's perspective, as this is very interesting to see it from the black's perspective. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board. We have c4, very flexible English opening, knight f6, we have knight f3, Radosław Wojtaszek is still waiting, and now we have d6. And now if white goes for something like knight c3, which of course is possible, or something like g3, which is of course also possible, then black gonna play e5 and control the center with the pawn. It was played of course plenty of times, but the main idea here is actually to transpose to the king's Indian defense. So this is what Radosław Wojtaszek is doing. So we have d4, g6, knight c3, bishop g7, e4, we have a castle, and now bishop e2, orthodox variation, the most popular main line. Of course we have e5, we have a castle, and now everybody knows who plays king's Indian or plays against king's Indian, that knight c6 is the main idea here. Very natural, d5, knight e7, and then b4, bayonet attack, and this is the popular. What is the main idea? That black attacks on the king side and white attacks on the queen side. For example, rook e1, then f5, and so on. So in the right moment, what white want to do is play c5, and then attack the base of this little pawn chain, and at the same time what black want to do is attack this pawn chain, the base of this pawn chain, or even push more and attack the pawn on f3 in the future and the position of the king. So this is very well known theory. However, Fabiano Caruana went for bishop g4, which is pretty much unorthodox way of playing king's Indian. And now Radosław Wojtaszek still have the option for, you know, going this move d5. This was also played plenty of times. The main idea for black would be a5, with the idea of bringing the knight to the c5, very nice outpost where it cannot be attacked, for example, by this pawn, because this pawn on a5 actually is controlling here. So even if the, you know, any moves like a3 is played, then this pawn can be moved and white have the problem. So what could happen here is, for example, knight e1. And after exchanging, then as I said, knight a6 and so on. The problem here is that actually white also gonna fight for this square. So this is the main idea. Of course, this didn't happen in the game, but I would like to just show you that white have a very nice, you know, established theory here, and black also, you know, attacking on the king side with the f3 moves and so on. This is what I all mentioned. However, Fabiano Caruana, you should actually pause the video maybe right now and come a little bit later, or maybe watch after, but I would like to just recommend to you to watch the interview with Fabiano Caruana, where he just actually said that we should also watch at this King's Indian a different way, because it can be played a completely different way. So after bishop g4, we don't have h3, because Radosław Wojtaszek just doesn't want to, you know, waste the tempo here. He immediately went for bishop e3. And now this bishop cannot be attacked by the knight, because of course the bishop stays over there. Also, maybe d5 can be played in the future, and this bishop could support, you know, moves like c5. But it looks like in the last years, the players rather waiting, the white players rather waiting for this pawn take on d4. So first, Fabiano Caruana took the knight, which is the defender of this pawn on d4. We have bishop f3. Now we have e takes on d4, bishop d4, and only now knight c6. So developing this way, and white have these pawns, which are not defended by other pawns yet. So they potentially can become the target. We have bishop e3, so white have the pair of bishops, and now rook e8. And here we have one game in the database where queen c2 was played. The game is interesting because the player who won that game, because won with the white pieces, had a 200 elo points less than the grandmaster who played. He was only like 2300 and he won with the white pieces. So this is why the game is interesting. And this queen, of course, is overprotecting the e4 pawn, which probably is very important. Also, another interesting idea here is because the position is not open yet, and these bishops could be potentially pretty vulnerable. For example, this knight could jump, for example, to e5. So probably g3, hiding the bishop to g2 would be good idea. Even the bishop, it's only watching at e4, so can be unhappy. But in the right moment, maybe this pawn could be sacrificed on e5, and this bishop would be pretty dangerous on this diagonal. So that could be some idea. However, Radosław Wojtaszek went for queen d2, not only setting up this very classical battery, in this case doesn't really matter because even if the bishop lands on h6, the bishop on g7 can actually retreat to h8 here, and this bishop, which actually, you know, should nowhere because there is no rook on f8, so that's the thing. But Fabiano Caruana has a different idea here, and I think I saw the tweet where one of the grandmasters said that this players played that last year, and we had a very similar. The difference was that the queen was still on the d1, so this was probably the reason that Wojtaszek wanted to keep an eye on this knight, because if this bishop, which we shouldn't actually exchange for the knight over there, strikes here, then the white gonna have this isolated pawns and double pawns, very very ugly, easy target for black. Risky, but okay. So we have rook a to d1, pretty normal stuff, and now the move which shocked all the chess world. So what happened here is Fabiano Caruana played bishop c3. Now this, why it's shocked? The first thing first, we have of course queen c3. We never, at least according to a lot of books, we never should exchange this dark square bishop even for the rook. There are a lot of examples where black actually exchange this bishop for the rook, and white actually get a very very nice attack with the dark square bishop, which can control all of the dark squares, and with the queen. So in this case, you already see that it looks like very dangerous. Checkmate in two, you know, one move, second move, and this is the checkmate. So it was quite shocking against all the principles. If you exchange this dark square bishop for the dark bishop, it's not the greatest idea, but is acceptable. But if you exchange for the knight, and you don't even get this double pawns on C, it's, you know, this is the chess on the top level. Now, Fabiano Caruana understands this position. He said that was not the preparation. However, he was playing a very similar game, as I said before. But now Fabiano Caruana played queen f6, saying, okay, now you have to make a choice. You're not gonna take this diagonal, of course, it's too dangerous for me. And now, choice. Take this queen, not take this queen. If the queens are exchanged, then actually this position, which probably would be rich. Of course, this pawn is attacked twice. It cannot really be defended. It should be somehow sacrifice. One of these pawns just lost. Probably the best option would be c5, and after exchanging these pawns, losing this, and then the bishop can retreat, and this pair of bishops still can be very very dangerous. Even black has one extra pawn. So this was of course possible. This bishop on the diagonal, you know, black have to be very very careful here about the pawn structure, especially because white in the right moment probably gonna exchange one of the bishops for the knight. However, Radosław Wojtaszek wants to keep the queen on the board, so we have queen c1 still staying on this diagonal. Also, if the queen is on the c2, potentially could be in some moment harassed by the knight. So here we have knight c5, and now if white decide, okay, these knights are very, very annoying, I want to exchange that, this actually would be the worst possible way of playing this position, because of course after moving the rook, defending, the problem is black would have this beautiful monster knight on the outpost, on the dark square, and white would not have even a chance to attack this knight. So this would be the, you know, the dream position for the knight, always in chess. This, if you have the position like that, just enjoy it, and this position are usually very fun to play. Queen b1, we have extra defender for the e4, but now queen e6. So Fabiano Caruana simply goes for this pawn a third time, and also goes for the pawn on c4. And here actually Radosław Wojtaszek have to choose which pawn to give, and he thought for a while he wanted to, you know, give away the pawn, but the best way that he gonna get some benefits from that, Fabiano Caruana said that he didn't achieve that, he could do better. So what is the best idea here? Probably b4, because then after knight e4, that would be forced, there is no other ways. Rook c1, otherwise the knight could jump to the c3. And then let's say after queen e5, rook f2, e1, f5, maybe taking care of this knight even extra, maybe g3, and then move this bishop to the g2. This bishop would be very, very happy on this diagonal, and the knights for now they are quite strong, but in the right moment, you know, if they're gonna move somewhere, it can be very, very annoying for black. So that was the way to go. According to the engine, actually the position is completely equal, despite the fact that black actually has one extra pawn. But we have rook f2 e1, so that's not the best way of giving them the pawn. We have queen c4, and after b3, queen c3, the maneuver of the queen is also remarkable. We have queen c3, quite annoying, slightly penetrating this position of the white pieces. Probably again g3, bishop g2 would be the best plan here in this position, but we have bishop d2 harassing the queen, and now queen just goes back to f6. We have bishop c1, so the plan is simple. What white want to do is control the dark squares and then finish the king off. But now Fabiano Caruana started to attack on the king side. H5, that's the first move. We have bishop b2, and now we have knight e5, and this is what I was talking about. If g3, bishop g2 is played, then of course white would have very strong f4 move harassing this knight. Of course Fabiano would never bring the knight if this g3, bishop g2 was played. However, that was not possible, you know, in this position. So this is another advantage of, you know, hiding this bishop to slightly better position. For now, the bishop, of course, is under attack with check, so there is no problem with this pin at all. So we have bishop e2 moving back, and now we have h4 taking under control g3. And now queen c1, a very interesting move. First, of course, it's want to go to the h6, but maybe in the future, if the d6 is weakened, then maybe that could be, you know, the target on the d6, because c6 and d5 probably will come on some point. We have g5 blocking that, and now bishop b5 provoking c6. But Fabiano Caruana is saying, I'm not interested in this yet. First we have rook e7, and now rook e3. We have also queen g6, now going after this pawn, and here Radosław Wojtaszek played very interesting move. Bishop e2, saying, okay, you can take my pawn. And Fabiano Caruana actually could take that pawn, but it would be, you know, very, very risky and complicated. I will just show you two variations what could happen potentially if this is played. And then Radosław Wojtaszek sacrificed the exchange here. So first of all, we would have queen g5. And then after king f8, queen h6, where to move the king? There are two options. What would you play? Actually, both of the moves are okay for black. That is nothing wrong with them. However, it's very interesting because after king e8, queen h8, of course, this rook is falling. So king d7, but also this bishop is unprotected, this bishop is unprotected. Once this bishop is taken, then also the rook is unprotected. So white probably would play something like bishop b5, and then after c6, queen a8, there is no time, of course, to attack the rook and so on. Also, all of these squares are controlled by the bishop. So very tricky position. After c takes on b5, then bishop e5, rook e5, there is some checkmate, so probably something like h3, and very interesting is rook g5, and this is the checkmate here on the g2, and there is only one saving move. You can actually try to, you know, find the move which is okay for white in this position, not losing move. I hope you see that already. Very nice tactic. Rook d6 with the check, and then after queen d8, we would have this position where the material is equal for the moment. However, the position is still very tricky. For example, queen e1 wins one of the pawns and defends both of these pawns, so black would have one extra pawn in the game. However, then white would have a little bit of the initiative and would start to make a couple of moves. So the position could be still very tricky. However, king g8 would be, you know, more straightforward without all of these exchanges, but we would have different exchanges because now white have this interesting move, bishop d3, setting up the bishop on this diagonal, and we have another bishop here. So of course the bishop cannot be taken because of the checkmate on g7. So probably rook e6 would have to be played, and after queen g5, just exchange everything this way, queen g6, and after that we would have probably something like that, knight g6, and so on. So again, the material is not equal. Black has one extra pawn and a little edge here. However, this bishop can be also very, very strong. There are a lot of pawns still on the board. However, we have rook a to e8. So Fabiano Caruana improved the positions of all the pieces first before he even starts. So like old masters, first improve the positions of the old pieces and only then strike. We have queen c2 now, taking care of the pawn, because now this pawn can be taken. There are no tricks with the rooks, as the rooks are connected. And now we have knight e6. We also have f3. Now this pawn is very well protected, but of course there is the hole on f4. So we have knight f4, bishop f1. And only now we have c6, preparing d5, which is very tricky because the pawn cannot be taken because the queen is hanging on c2. So that's why we have queen f2, and now improving the last position of the last piece. So now black are ready to strike. This rook on e6 gonna stay on the 6th rank, and from there, maybe if needed, can potentially attack the position of the king. So very, very precise the last moment where Fabiano Caruana gonna attack like old masters, like I show you some of the games of Akiba Rubinstein. So that's one of the ways. Of course, now these double rooks can make some, you know, harm to this rook. So first we have rook c3 by Wojtaszek, and only now d5. And here is the critical moment of the game where Radosław Wojtaszek is in troubles, but he has to be very, very precise now in defense. Probably rook e3, you know, moving back would not be the best idea. Of course, the human usually don't do that. However, what could happen actually if he takes on the e4? It's not that, you know, some match is happening here. Black would still have to find the way how to break through, and the position is pretty solid. It's more and more opened. So also black have to be very careful, because if the pair of bishops start to play, it can be very dangerous. However, we have g3, a necessary move, and now after h takes on g3, Now, Fabiano Caruana actually missed the best move in the position, but this is typical, you know, engine moves where you have a lot of calculations. You have to play something like g4. And now the main idea, of course, is that white gonna take the knight, and then after knight f3, king g2. This can be very, very dangerous. Some discovered checks, probably queen g3, and then after knight d2. The king has to move, then rook h6, and you already see that that's gonna be very, very dangerous. But it's not that easy. Bishop g2 attacking the queen, and now what next? Queen e2 probably. Rook is under attack, rook d2 c1, and then knight e4. And this is very, very tricky here. Again, the queen is under attack. The queen has to move somewhere, but we cannot find really the squares for the queen. So probably bishop e4, and after queen e4, maybe queen g2. Just to cover this diagonal, that would be deadly. And then after, let's say, queen d4 with the check, king f1, queen f4. Very interesting maneuver. Queen f4, and after king g1, queen d4 back. And finally, the rook would win on the f6, okay? As still very, very tricky. Of course, the queen controls all of this. Another rook controls all of this. So rook f3 is forced. And after exchanging everything, queen f3, queen b2, now we have the rook under attack, the queen under attack, so the best what can be done here is queen g4, but now if we count the pieces, we have three extra pawns, so black gonna comfortably win the position. Probably there were some better lines, but this is completely enough, of course, to win. But the problem is that white doesn't need to take this knight immediately. Can play something like bishop c1 and then take it after. So probably the knight would have to go somewhere like knight h3. And after bishop h3, g takes on h3, e takes on d5, maybe knight d3 would be tricky, together with the rook. It's still very, very strong attack, so very difficult to find the defending for white pieces. Of course, taking this knight is the must, but then black gonna win the queen. So for example, rook d4, rook f2, king f2, and then after queen c2, what white can try here to do actually is just block this attacks of the queen. The one rook defends the bishop, and another rook just harass the queen. And after queen c5, this is not longer possible. Rook d4, then maybe something like h2, but still bishop e3, and position is extremely tricky now, because the rook controls h1. Now this rook gonna come, for example, to g4 with the attack on the queen. Is still a lot to do here. Probably the best would be actually rook e3, king e3, and then play c takes on d5. But you know, two rooks against the queen, it's still a lot to play. And yes, this pawn is definitely a huge advantage, but it's not that easy to actually promote it now. So, you know, probably white would get it, but black would get also some advantage, exchange it for some other things. So this was the best what could be done for black, and it was not that easy. However, in our game, we have d takes on e4, and now Radosław Wojtaszek has the last chance to play the best move in the position, which is actually f takes on e4. And now this knight would have to retreat, and then white can try to, for example, exchange the queens. Queen h6, avoiding that. And after bishop c1, white gets some really nice counterplay. Really nice. Rook g6, maybe queen h3. And black have to be extremely, extremely careful, because, you know, these two bishops, if they start to play, they can be very, very dangerous. So that was the last chance where Radosław Wojtaszek should play. But now he decided that, okay, this is time to take this knight. And now his king is completely open. And as you already see, this rook can be very, very handy on the 6th rank. So, of course, we have g takes on f4 with the check. We have queen g2. and now e takes on f3. So Fabiano Caruana tripled his pawns, but these pawns are the monsters. In close to the king position, they are extremely, extremely strong. We have queen g6, rook takes on g6 with the check, and now if the king wants to actually go after these pawns, that wouldn't be the best idea, because after rook g3, we're gonna have the checkmate in the next move, and this rook actually controls all of this square. So a king would have to run, but still, we're gonna have knight d3, double check, king d2, knight b2, getting back the material, and now black have this 4 pawns actually extra to win the game. You cannot catch this knight actually because of the rook g2, and after bishop g2, rook e2 with the check, king c1, and only now f takes on g2 and promotion in the next move. Everything what white can do is here is rook c2, and after promotion escape this way, but of course it's the queen against the rook, so there is no chance. Queen d4 and it's all over. The rook is pinned. If the king goes there, we're gonna have the checkmate, and if the king goes to the a3, we would have of course completely winning position. So that's why we have king h1, the only move. But now f2, threatening rook g1, and the position is extremely tricky, because now, okay, you think, okay, maybe king h2 and everything is fine, however after rook g1, what you gonna play next? You would like to, you know, win this pawn. How to win that pawn? With the rook, because with the bishop you cannot, another rook probably also cannot, because this bishop is hanging, and the problem is if you take with the this rook, you're gonna get checkmated this way. Okay, so there are some mating ideas here, you have to be also very careful. So that's why we have bishop h3, taking under control f1, but also taking under control all of these squares. But now Fabiano Caruana played a completely stunning move. The best move on the position is knight c4. Knight c4 going after the bishop, and of course if the knight is taken, then we're gonna have rook e1. This is very serious. The problem is even you take care of that, then you're gonna have knight b2, and now you cannot take this pawn because you're gonna get forked, and black of course gonna win with the extra exchange and extra 3 pawns, so no problem about that. And even if white tries to play something interesting like rook f3, maybe try to get these pawns, it's not enough. Knight d1 first defending, and it doesn't really matter you take immediately or not, that you're gonna have first get rook e1, and after king h2, yes, the rook is still defended, but after rook g1 has to make the decision what to make next. If taking that, then of course we're gonna have knight f2, rook f2, and after rook h1, we're gonna also win this bishop and the game. So at the end that would just not work. So this is why we have rook c4, but now after rook e1, Radosław Wojtaszek resigned. And he resigned because if he takes the rook, then of course black gonna promote to the queen, win the game, and if king h2 is played, then rook d1 winning this rook, and it still looks like okay, it's still playable. We have two rooks, we have a pair of bishops and a rook, so it's okay. However, after rook f4, what you gonna play next? Because this is the best move in the position, controlling f1, double control now. The problem is that promoting is still enough to win for black, because now after rook f1, we always gonna have this rook d2 winning the bishop, so exchange is going to become this way. There is even no way the king has to stay. Look at the king, the king is completely locked over there, and black has two extra pawn and the exchange, and also the king is completely in the corner, so there is no way that anything can happen So, of course, Radosław Wojtaszek, after Rook E1, just resigned. A very interesting game. Bishop C3 could even, you know, consider to exchange the dark squared bishop. That was quite shocking. As always, I would like to show you the standing. So, we have three leaders. Anish Giri, Fabiano Caruana, and Alireza Firuzia are on the lead. 6 points out of nine. So, pretty nice. Andrzej Sipienko and Jordan Van Forest, 5.5 points. We have also Magnus Carlsen with 5 points. Pentala Hare Krishna, Nils Grandelius on the half, so they have the equal 4.5 points. Jan Krzysztof Duda, Radosław Wojtaszek, Arian Tari, and David Anton, 3.5 points. And big surprise, Maxim Vasil Lagraf, only 3 points out of nine. Last place together with Alexander Donchenko. So if you like this video, press like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike. And if you don't want to miss other games on Tata Steel 2021, press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching and see you in the next one.